The Bible is full of urgent appeals to believe. Jesus announces in the first chapter of Mark that the time has come, the kingdom of God has come near, and then he gives that invitation to repent and believe the good news. The evangelist John writes his gospel so that you might believe. And Dr. Luke, well, he records this history of the early church, including that incident where the jailer housing Paul and Silas, he asked breathlessly, "What must I do to be saved?" And the answer, as in so many other instances in the Bible, is simple. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. So what does it mean to believe? Let's answer that question in this video. We begin at this point. True belief is not easy. The belief that the Bible refers to, particularly New Testament belief, is not just mental assent to the idea of God. Simply saying, "I believe in God," is not biblical belief. When all that means is that you agree with the concept of God, well, you're a little better off than one who claims to believe in this unnamed higher power. Even when belief is specific, as in, "I believe in Jesus Christ," well, if that belief is just anchored in one's belief that, you know, Jesus walked on the earth at some point in the past, well, again, that belief falls short of the biblical standard. So if we dismiss these things as not viable, what is belief that leads to salvation? Because proper belief has eternal ramifications, it's crucial that we get it right. The belief that the Bible connects with salvation has a singular focus, and it's this: whether or not you believe that in his death, Jesus was the atoning sacrifice for all your sin, and then that by believing in him, you can receive from God forgiveness and eternal life in his presence. In other words, believing in Jesus is not simply believing that he existed or even believing that, you know, he was the Son of God. Those are important truths, but your faith is anchored to him as Savior. You're believing in what he uniquely does upon the cross at Calvary, that God accepts him as the sufficient sacrifice to pay the penalty for all of the sin of all of humankind. Believing in that truth is the foundation of faith, faith that you are forgiven in God's eyes through no activity of your own. In the example I gave just a moment ago from Acts chapter 16, missionaries Paul and Silas were in a Philippian jail when an incredible earthquake strikes, knocking the prison doors wide open. The Roman soldier that's watching over the prisoners is terrified because he's going to have to pay with his life for the escaped prisoners. The story takes a really important turn as the Apostle Paul comforts him. He assures him that no one has escaped, everybody's there. Now the jailer comes to this realization of his mortality right at that moment. And he turns to these two evangelists and he asks about salvation. "What must I do to be saved?" To which they give the answer that you and I may have given to other people as well. "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved." Now, unlike other interactions that we see Paul engaged in, he doesn't explain who Jesus is or the nature of God or any of the other myriad concepts that he's had to explain. So that tells us something. We recognize right away that belief is not going to be merely factual belief. We could comfortably say that the soldier has some concept of who God is and what he's asking, since he specifically queries about salvation, about being saved. So the belief that the missionaries call for is very specific. Believing in the Lord Jesus means humbly acknowledging that he accomplished our salvation. Now, even saying that, giving that example, can lead our understanding of belief to be only mental, as in acknowledging in our mind that Jesus was God's son and he died on the cross for our sins. But listen, we can survey our relationships and see the number of people that mentally believe that truth, but we also see that it makes very little difference in their lives. When we seek to understand biblical belief, we need to see that it includes a volitional side as well. We're introduced to this side of the equation in the Lord's announcement in Mark chapter 1 when Jesus says we need to repent and believe. We should see repentance as belief in action, as the other side of the same coin. Repentance and belief, as the Bible demonstrates, are two dimensions of the same thing. When we believe not only that Jesus lived and died, but we believe he lived and died for us. And then we choose to rest our hopes for salvation on that, on what he's done for humankind. We believe that Jesus is Lord as a historical fact. Yeah, that's for sure. But in our humility, in our repentant humility, we recognize that he is our king, our sovereign to whom we submit in obedience. One test for true biblical belief is that we assume a new posture towards the lordship of Jesus. What he says, we do, and what he commands, we obey. Another thing that we notice in the Bible's examples of belief is that it's not associated with any kind of ceremony. We never see a person asking Jesus to come into their heart, nor do we see the text of the sinner's prayer printed anywhere. This kind of belief, as common as it is what leads to doubt as life unfolds. The further one gets from that moment where we prayed the sinner's prayer and believed, the more doubts can creep in. We start to wonder if we did it right. Did we say the words right? Do we say them in the right order? We ask ourselves if we were sorry enough for our sin. We may even notice that our life isn't being transformed the way the preacher says it should. The reason that we don't see this kind of doubt and lack of assurance in the Bible is because Scripture portrays the moment of salvation much, much differently. Belief, anchored in the lordship of Christ, reminds us that we have been in rebellion against the rule of God, and that the wrath that is ours was taken by Jesus. We see Jesus as Lord, both factually and in our lives. Theologian John Murray saw the same thing, and he laid out three elements particular to the faith in the Bible. He describes it there as a transference of reliance from ourselves and all our human resources to reliance on Christ alone for salvation. He goes on to say that faith is trust in a person, the person of Christ, the Son of God, and the Savior of the lost. And don't miss this. It is entrusting ourselves to him. Belief isn't easy, but it's essential. And what we believe, in whom we believe, is worthy of your reflection. My friends, anchor your belief in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Let it rest there, and your heart will rest secure. God's richest blessings to you.